Als nächstes möchte ich Gijs Hillenius begrüßen. Gijs ist extra aus Brüssel zu uns gereist, weil nicht weil wir in der Schweiz keine Open Source Success Stories hätten, auch in der Bundesverwaltung und in der öffentlichen Verwaltung gibt es einige davon. Aber Gijs ist in dem Sinn, hat noch einen viel besseren Überblick als ein einzelner IT-Verantwortlicher, weil er ist selber Journalist und Redaktor von der Plattform JoinUp von der EU, von der Europäischen oder von der Europäischen Kommission. Er wird uns nun als nächstes einige Einblicke geben, wie heute Open Source Software in öffentlichen Verwaltungen europaweit eingeführt wird. Gijs ist IT-Journalist und genau, ich lese Ihnen jetzt nicht die Beschreibung ab, aber Sie werden hören, er ist sehr kompetent.
Okay, I already announced this during the questions. I will do this in English because I speak German, I read German, I can understand your talks, but you know, I will not make you laugh by trying to speak it here. Thanks, Matthias, for the invitation. I'm happy to see so many people here. I'm happy to talk on success stories of open source implementations in public administrations. That's specifically the topic that I've been writing about since 2007. When I was lucky enough to be in the consortium that won a procurement bid for the OSOR platform, the Open Source Observatory and Repository, recently renamed JoinUp. I don't know how many people here have known know OSOR or know JoinUp. Okay, that's far too little. So I'll be talking a lot about JoinUp, so after this you will know it. Have you heard of opengovernment.ch? Okay, so that's very similar. It's a Swiss initiative to bring together information and code that can be used and reused by other public administrations. So, a few things about JoinUp. It's a project at the European Commission, it says it right there, to create and to reuse applications that can be used and are useful for public administrations across the EU. And it's run by a part of the Commission that somehow involves Switzerland a lot. It's the ISA project, and they look at a lot of European countries, and it includes Turkey, and it includes Switzerland. So, you know, it makes it a bit logical that I talk here. And what does it have? At the top row, you'll see a few very important tabs. One of them is software. That's where public administrations can find applications that have been developed by other public administrations available for reuse. I'll give a few examples later down my talk. It has a lot of information. There's procurement guidelines, TCO studies. There's examples for how to develop policies. There are examples for how to write a public procurement so that you will, without breaking any laws, be able to select open source. Besides, one thing, you do not have to procure open source. You may download it legally under the European rules. Don't know how much they are valid here. There's a lot of case studies that I welcome you to read that give you in detail how public administrations move to open source and what stumbling blocks they came across. There's 4,000 software projects on the Forge, public administrations, public projects. We had in the month of August 1,000 projects that were downloaded. Doesn't sound like a lot, but to me it's a lot. It's because it's public administrations that think, hey, this is an application that I happen to be looking for, and here it is. It's free, it's been developed by another public administration, and we can help them improve it even. There's three things important for public administrations when going to JoinUp. You need to find the software, and we're not always very successful in it because we federate other repositories. We federate repositories from Spain and from France and from Germany, from England, from the Netherlands, and these people develop software mostly in their own language. So we have machine translation to help translate quickly the descriptions of the software, and it doesn't always work, but finding the software is one of the challenges. Then public administrations need to write it in a way that it can be reused. It makes no sense if we have an Estonian application written in Estonian with the documentation in Estonian, made available under the GPL, but nobody understands it. It will not be reused a lot. So, Matthias wanted me to talk about success stories, and I will try to do that. First of all, are there a few trends that I see? Because I've been writing about public administrations using open source since 2006. Well, it's used all over the EU, and it's used in all kinds of public administrations. I can literally, I can give examples of anything involving open source. We have a lot of content management systems. It will not surprise anybody here. There's a lot of document management systems, database applications. As soon as it involves one of those, open source, as an alternative, props up. E-government services, there's a lot of governments modernizing their IT, bringing their services online. This mostly involves open source in the back end. The biggest success story is the geographic information space. Of course, GIS. Who here knows GIS or works with GIS? Okay, there's a few more hands. Great. Then you will work with open source tools, probably. And what I see not so much, and it will also not surprise many people, is on the desktop side, things are more difficult to change there. So it happens a lot. Don't get the wrong impression, but it's less fluid than the rest. And there's a few, the last few years I've written about a few cases where public administrations think, let's try open source, and then they're halfway and then decide to stop. That's only a handful. I've written about 1,500 examples, and there's like five of them that regress, and they're always debatable of why. So, and what I see a lot, unfortunately, is mistakes in procurement. Public administrations that ban the GPL, for example. No idea why. Public administrations that forbid open source solutions to be offered. No idea why. They usually don't answer the questions, though. Okay, a few success stories. The top three, France, the Gendarmerie. The link is on the top. It's a very nice recent case study published by Ubuntu. They do 85,000 desktops. They are moving them to Ubuntu. They have 4,500 police stations all over France, and it includes 130 police stations in French Polynesia. This is one of my favorite stories, because the guy that explained this to me is a lieutenant general in the French gendarmerie, and he said, well, I was working on an Excel sheet, and at home I used OpenOffice. And so I had brought it to work, and I showed it to my boss, and my boss said, hey, what do you mean it's for free? And it works, it's the same. He decided to run a small pilot. And then the proprietary vendor of Excel heard about this, and they got a bit angry, so they put pressure on the boss. And then the boss said, yeah, I get these angry calls from my salespeople, and can you come in and show me what is this about? So the guy came and showed him OpenOffice, said, well, it does text editing, it does spreadsheeting, it does presentations, it does everything. And it's for free? Yeah, it's for free. Well, maybe we should do this for the whole group then. That's how it got started. They're migrating at the moment 10,000 desktops per year, which means that they'll be done in 2015. And then they expect to have migrated 90%. And this is a number that I come across more often. 80%, 90% of the desktops can be moved to a free operating system. The other 10 are locked in because of some applications, usually accounting. The savings at the moment, the number that comes from the case is not that impressive. It's 2 million euros per year on proprietary licenses that they lower the cost, and the rest is apparently the same. So back to the Polynesian island, because I said it's my favorite story. They have 130 islands out there above Australia, and they used to have a police officer who had to fly out there and then visit island to island to island to island to island by boat to update the viruses, the virus antivirus software, and to update the Windows machines. And then the guy said, well, now we don't have to do that anymore. So it took him a year to travel from all those islands and come back, and then he had to go away again to start all over. And now they don't have to do it, and it takes them 2 weeks to update anything, and they can do it remotely. A lot of savings there. So, but I welcome you to read the case study, because I'm racing through the data here. I wish I had a better screenshot of Linux. Who here has heard of Linux in Munich? Okay. Well, I'm glad I'm reporting a bit of news here. So these are just a few of the articles that I've written over the past years on what happens in Munich, in Bavaria. This is the second largest example that we have in Europe of a complete move to open source alternatives. 14,000 PCs, this is only the front end, and it includes their schools. The Munich government also takes care of schools. And they have a lot of offices all around town, and they're slowly moving everything to Ubuntu. Their goal is actually not to move to open source, and that's maybe the wrong goal. Their goal is to become more independent from IT vendors. And the guys there, they're saying, look, we're making all our applications platform independent. And when it's platform independent, then we can, it doesn't matter which operating system we use for the desktop. It can be Mac, it can be Windows, it can be anything else. And there's a few applications that will depend on an operating system, and those we run through terminal application services. One thing that is interesting in Munich, is they have developed an application that helps them manage their thousands of macros that had been written over the years. This thing is called WolMux, and I heard that name mentioned before in the talk. It's the most popular software application on the JoinUp platform. A lot of other public administrations are having the same problems. We have a lot of departments. They have developed their own macros. We need to maintain these things. They're usually undocumented. They're very old. They still work. WolMux helps you out of that problem. It does also migrate you away from a proprietary software system. A success story, that was the goal of my talk. Germany, people here might know it or not, has also one of the regressions, one of the failures. The Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Germany, aware of it or not, maybe I shouldn't talk about it. They were on a project to move all of their embassies and the Foreign Office itself over to free software solutions, and they stopped. And it was basically a lack of support within the users. It's an interesting case to look at because it tells you what you need to do. I will come back to that a little bit later when I talk about Finland. But they had one or two people that talked to all the organization. It's not enough. It's a big organization, 7,000 users. And if you have a little bit of support and a lot of antipathy from users that don't want to change, it's not going to work. But success stories. It's better to talk about success stories. Extremadura is actually the second largest example, but they're less. It's a bit new, so Germany, Munich is better. Has only 14,000 desktops. Extremadura, we're talking about 40,000 desktops. It's a bit bigger. It's one of the 17 autonomous regions in Spain. It's in the south. And they have always been working on open source. A lot of it was used in schools. When you look at the numbers, Spain and Portugal, we're talking about thousands, hundreds of thousands of desktops that are running open source in schools. In the government, not so much. There's a few cities, a few municipalities here and there. Extremadura, at the beginning of this year, decided, look, we're out of money. We have to pay all these licenses. We can't afford it. We already have, apparently, an experiment running open source on our desktops. Well, we'll just roll it out. 40,000 desktops, and they're working on it. I spoke to the CIO. He was under a lot of fire in the press for having fired the desktop project that they were working on. And he said, we used to make our own little Linux distribution. That's not very smart. We'll just take one of those that's out there. I think it's Debian or Ubuntu. And we'll roll it out everywhere we can. And we'll try to do this with as little budget as we can. And what was the reason? I want to unify all my desktops. I want to make them strong. I want them easy to be managed. I want remote support, like the guy in French Polynesia. And I don't want viruses, and I don't want any security issues. Good reason for me. Another success story, Finland. I gave you the top three, and I will race through Europe, give you a few examples all over the map, and hopefully that will help you visit the site more often and learn things there. The Finland Ministry of Justice, 12,000 desktops, they had, over the course of the years, they ran Lotus Notes, a few OpenOffice things, a few LibreOffice things, and Microsoft Office. They had it all over the organization. And the CEO, he recently retired. hopefully not because of this, he tried to look at the TCO and he couldn't figure it out. TCO calculations are impossible to do. But here he had a few things that he could measure. He had the costs of the licenses and the cost of running these three office suites. A Lotus Notes was actually the cheapest in his report, but they decided to go with OpenOffice. It costed them to move 2 million euros, and if they would have stayed with the ubiquitous alternative, Microsoft Office, it would have costed them like four times as much, 7 million euros. And this is 300 offices around the country, 7,000 users. They have it installed in courts, in prisons, well, not in their cells, prosecution enforcement, the state legal aid offices, the people that help people when they come out of prison, re-socialize into society, and so on. And what is interesting about Finland, why do I mention it here? The guy wrote his PhD thesis on it, and then he retired. And he saw a few things that I think are worth mentioning here. And if you are considering looking at open source, this thesis, it's a thesis, so it's difficult to read. I read it a few times in order to be able to write about it. There's a few things that come out. He says you need an innovation champion. You need one person who is willing to talk to each and everybody that has a problem with why we're doing this and explain why we're doing this. If you don't have such a person, don't start. It's not going to work. So you need one innovation champion, is his word. And then he said, within my IT organization, a few things were very remarkable that changed while we were experimenting with this open office. First, we didn't understand any of it. So I took five people and myself, and I went to an open source conference. And we looked around and we thought, hey, it's interesting, this Linux, we'll install it, we'll run with it. So that's a little bit how they seeded their organization, to become enthusiastic about this free and open source software thing. But he said, so I had a few testers, and they run expensive tests. They have, you know, the test department and put it in practice and production. And here we have things, and I don't have to buy licenses. I can just run tests, and if it works, I can actually roll it out. And my e-tail organization changed because of that. And while we were still thinking about the pilot phase, and we already had it run all over the organization. It was an important change for him in his mind of how free software actually changes not just what your desktop looks like or what your software looks like, but how it involves all of the change in your organization. So really, I recommend, it's at the bottom of this article, recommend you grab the PhD thesis. I wrote about it a few times because it's an interesting PhD thesis, and it became the most popular PhD thesis at the university, for which he thanked me. While we're in Finland, capital Helsinki, that's another of the regressions. It's also an example of how you can always kill an IT project. Helsinki, the city council, they have asked the IT department to do a pilot. And not only to do a pilot, but to actually run open source more on their systems. And the CIO basically says, look, please, we'll give you open data, we'll do anything you want, but don't ask me to move my IT system. It's too complex, it's too hard, there's too much legacy, I can't do it. I think he has a hard time because the father of Linus Torvalds is in the city council of Helsinki. So they'll be on his back. I'll skip Sweden because Daniel will talk a little bit about it, though maybe not the success stories there, but go over to Denmark. This is, for me, healthcare, the healthcare organizations are within public administration, so I count them in when I write articles. So it's these two things. First, healthcare. Because I said before when I started racing through Europe that I can find examples of anything on anything in any public administration on JoinUp. Healthcare is an important sector for open source. There's a lot out there. There's examples in the Czech Republic, in the Netherlands, in Portugal, in Spain, and this is the biggest one, and it's in Denmark. You can read it, 25,000 staffers moving to OpenOffice, and it's saving them millions per year in licenses, according to the reports. Then, an interesting project, I think, for the part of reuse and sharing, It's ting with, and the I is an exclamation mark. Makes it impossible to put online. And these guys, it's 40 out of 100 municipalities in Denmark. They run their libraries, their public libraries, and they decided to pool their resources when they are developing systems to put their library resources online. It's not a library system that's out there, but it's getting all these libraries to work together, get the same front end. How do we get to our books, our loan administration, and so on? And it's saving them a lot of effort. So it's a share and reuse example. And in Denmark, you have a lot of municipalities that are active on open source, either on content management systems or on document management systems or on e-services or on the office site. France, which means I'm skipping a few slides. OK. Before I get to French, guys, bear with me for 5 seconds. Denmark, I did. The Netherlands, a lot of policy that you can find on JoinUp. And two examples that you cannot find on JoinUp: the Ministry of Defense using LibreOffice, and the Ministry of Foreign Affairs dual booting with OpenOffice. I mean, dual booting, they have both Microsoft Office and OpenOffice next to each other. An interesting country for those interested in databases or in GIS is Luxembourg, where the cadastral administration is basically only working with open source. They have a few desktop applications that need Windows underneath, but the rest, the CEO explained to me recently, is when they can use open source, they will use open source. And the big reason was they were forced to upgrade their database license by a proprietary database manufacturer, Oracle, and they didn't really want to, but they had to. Well, they said, we don't need to. Yeah, but you have to. So they got a bit angry at Oracle, and they decided to move it to Postgres. It's an interesting story. Belgium, it's also a small country on the way to France. yeah, it's a small country, but they have a few very nice examples. The province of Luxembourg, don't mix it up with the country, they moved their voice over IP system. They used Cisco, and then they could only call to the people in the headquarters using Cisco, and had to use an outside line to call everybody else. And now they moved to Asterisk, the open source alternative, and they have connected all their offices for the same amount of money. They're very happy with that. And the one thing that it did there is that the guys that helped them install trained their IT administrators how to program the Asterisk scripts. And so now they can actually do things themselves instead of having to call the supplier all the time. Another good example is Commune Plon. It's a Zopi. Who knows Zopi? It's a Python-based content management system, roughly. It's developed. Commune Plon is a e-government services platform for municipalities, developed by one or two people in the French-speaking part of Belgium, and it's being used by 60 municipalities in that region. It's being used also in France, in Italy, in Spain, and I think even here in Switzerland. And it helps you, manage your communal agenda. It helps you do your town planning. It helps you do your website. And it saves you a lot of effort and money because you're leaning on other people, their work, on the work of other people to get your tasks done. But now France. I already mentioned the gendarmerie. It's the biggest example. There's a lot of open source being used in the Paris region. But an interesting project there is Adulact. It's the parent of JoinUp. It's they that gave the idea to the commission saying, hey, guys, you need a portal to do this whole share and reuse thing with all these free applications out there. And that's how JoinUp got started. And Adulact is celebrating its 10th birthday next week in Montpellier. And you should go. It's very interesting, their program as well. But they have an interesting project. Yeah, here it is. Open Mairie. It's one of my favorite projects. Open Mairie led to a project called Open Cemetery. And I love writing about open cemeteries. It makes nice headlines. But Open Cemetery is developed by the city of Arles in the south of France, and they needed the solution to manage their cemeteries. They have 8, and there's 11,000 concessions in them, and they have to rotate them. They have a database that has 32,000 people that are deceased in it. They have pictures of the deceased. They have 11,000 documents on these people and on these concessions. And they had a few proprietary vendors try it, And they said, we might as well do it ourselves, right? And they did it themselves, a little web application based on MySQL. And they made it available for others. And it is one of the most popular projects out there. It's being used already by 300 municipalities in France. So you write it once, and you don't have to sell it 300,000 times. You just, you know, you use it yourself. You download it, and you go with it. And I was talking about this in the Czech Republic earlier this year, I think. And then the Dutch administration of the Belgian city of Schoten said, hey, we need one of those. We were just about to procure one. And they, while I was talking about it, they pulled up OpenMRE, they downloaded the code, they looked at it, hey, it would fit. It's web-based, so it's not a problem. So now Schoten is also considering to use this. So, as I said, it's an example of sharing and reusing. Sorry guys, this was Communes Ploon from Belgium. I had the slides mixed up. I did this in a great hurry yesterday evening. But Matthias said, well, I need slides, right? So, okay, good. Italy. I'm almost at the end of my talk, by the way. Italy. It's a country where you'll find a lot of policies. Almost all the regions in Italy have a policy that says we will, if we can, use open source. There's even a national law about it that was approved last week. And the real active regions are around Bologna and in Sud Tyrol. And then one that I think you should all look at seriously is the UK portal that they built recently on open source policies. Because the UK is very, very serious when they consider moving to open source. They have looked at the effect it has on the small and medium-sized enterprises in their countries, which are currently nowhere in procurement. It's always the big four. And they want to get those smaller companies in there. And they also want to get rid of all the money that they spend on applications that they consider to be commodity. They say, look, if it's a commodity, we should be paying commodity prices. And apparently we're not. So open source is a way to break open this market, which is locked in. I gave you the link to their most active site. And they have lists there. One of the things I was interested in is they have a list of proprietary applications, the database, the desktop, operating systems, management systems, security systems, proprietary, and on the other column is the open source alternative. They've looked at both and they say, if you use this, you might as well use that. This costs you money, this doesn't cost you money. And with that, I've run around Europe very quickly, taking gigantic steps. But again, you should go to JoinUp and find the public administration that you work in and see which others in your area are doing things with open source. Literally, there is no article that I've written over the past years that will not show that they are not saving money. They are all saving money with this. That's the big conclusion that I draw, and not only me, it was an independent report from the university in England that said the same. There are no examples of public administrations moving to open source where it has become more expensive. In fact, it's the opposite. They are all saving money with it. Thanks.
Vielen Dank, Ries.